luckily, because my talk is really long, Dr. Azat talked about some stuff already, so I can skip over that, and then some of it you'll just have to come next year to hear the rest of it. So I was asked to kind of give a really brief overview of evaluation and management of parathyroid disorders. I'm not going to really talk about anything that has to do with MEN1 because that was covered, but it's all sort of, you know, goes together. So what do we know? What's our epidemiology today? So sporadic primary hyperparathyroidism, which is what this talk is going to be about, is present in at least 0.1% of the adult population, and the incidence has been shown in recent epidemiological studies to increase to at least 2% or higher for middle-aged females, and it's increasing. Importantly, the studies have also shown that many cases are not only undiagnosed, but those that are diagnosed are left untreated and, quote, followed and not sent for either surgery or management. So I like this slide that I made, which kind of shows how the presentation of the disease as we know it have changed over the years. So back in the day, the medical students would learn stones, bones, and psychiatric overtones for hyperparathyroid disease. And if you follow the literature along, then you started hearing terms like asymptomatic, normal calcemic. Dr. Azat mentioned some of these atypical hyperparathyroids where we see normal PTH levels but high calcium, mild, and then in one of our endocrine surgery meetings, we heard the term normal hormonal a few years ago, which seems a little bit weird because endocrine disorders are hormone disorders. So it's changing. And this is shown by a couple studies here. I'll just sort of briefly go through it, that the presentation of the disease changes. So we're seeing more and more patients that have lower or milder calcium levels than we did before. And this on the right is a recent paper from 2012, which again just shows that we're seeing a lot more of these atypical hyperparathyroidism patients. This is another similar study published with Kaiser data by some of our colleagues here in California, showing some of the similar things. So what does this mean for us as clinicians to treat this disease? So in these atypical patients, the studies have shown that there's an increased risk of multi-gland disease, which we'll get into in a second. For the surgeon, this means that your PTH kinetics in the operating room sometimes change, that maybe you have to be a little bit careful when you're using intraoperative PTH and how quickly the PTH is going to drop. Again, your adenomas may be smaller. We're going to localize our parathyroids with imaging less frequently, and what this is going to lead to, unfortunately, might be some additional bilateral neck explorations. So this is what I like to teach my students, residents, fellows, is common things are common. So most commonly, people have a single functioning parathyroid adenoma when we're talking about all comers and we exclude MEN1 patients. And importantly, it may be present for many years before it's actually diagnosed. Only occasionally do we find patients that actually have two hyperfunctioning adenomas or four-gland hyperplasia, again, if you exclude patients that do not have hereditary disorders. And again, I'm not going to go into this that much, but when you do find four-gland hyperplasia unexpectedly or more than one gland involved, you really have to have in the back of your mind, is this a hereditary syndrome that needs to be worked up or that I've missed? So because this is an endocrine disorder, really the diagnosis should only be made by biochemical dysfunction. So checking a calcium level, a PTH level, as was mentioned, it's really important to rule out causes of secondary hyperparathyroidism before you give somebody the diagnosis. So vitamin D and creatinine level, and sometimes a 24-hour urine calcium. Some of the newer guidelines talk about considering other things like bone mineral density, stone analysis in your preliminary workup. And there are lots of algorithms out there. Everybody loves algorithms. This is one that came out of the Cleveland Clinic that talks about, can we calculate if someone has primary hyperpara even if their vitamin D is low? So who definitely needs surgery? And I can tell you the answer to this differs by not only if you talk to an endocrinologist or a surgeon, but which surgeon or which endocrinologist you talk to. So this is I'm going to say my opinion. So importantly, it's the only, for patients with primary hyperpara, surgery is the only potentially curable option. This is a surgical disease. So I think most people would agree that everybody that has biochemically definitive hyperpara, where calcium is more than one above the normal range and PTH is over 100, those patients should go to surgery. Please keep in mind, though, as was mentioned with reference ranges before by Dr. Swerdloff, is that sometimes the upper limit of normal and the reference ranges, these were all done in populations where we all know now that everybody's vitamin D deficient. So that and other factors may really affect what the upper limit of normal should be. So even though the reference range of PTH may say 65, it really may be 55 given the incidence of vitamin D deficiency and other issues. So normal calcemic hyperparathyroidism is also a recognized indication for surgery, especially in patients that meet one of these criteria. And a lot of people might also recommend it in people that have normal calcemic hyperpara and might not meet one of these definitive criteria but have symptoms or otherwise are good candidates. And same thing would go for patients that have high calcium with a abnormally normal parathyroid level. So we all ask for symptoms of hyperparathyroidism, and many patients are actually what we would call asymptomatic even when you ask them all these questions. So briefly, I'm going to flip through these slides, but this past year there was an update on what we do with these asymptomatic hyperpara patients. And I've just highlighted in blue the changes that were produced from the latest consensus conference, which pretty much just talks about some of these new ways to diagnose or monitor patients, to look at their vertebral fracture list, to do a stone analysis, and they put the 24 urine calcium sort of back in the game in order to try to tease out, or I should say put more people in the we recommend surgery category. The other thing they also talked about is ideally they should be referred to an experienced endocrine surgeon at least to discuss their options, whether or not they're going to have surgery or not. And also the benefits of having a multidisciplinary endocrine conference and endocrine team that's taking care of these patients. I'm not going to go through monitoring, but there are recommendations for monitoring patients who do not go not undergo surgery in asymptomatic hyperparathyroidism, and guidelines for who, in during the follow-up, if things change, should have surgery. Briefly, I want to talk about some imaging. A, really important, it's not for diagnosis. This is, once you've made the diagnosis, then we try to find the disease. So for me, as a surgeon who does my own ultrasounds, and even for people who don't, ultrasound is a quick, easy, non-invasive way and should probably be the primary imaging. And then whatever your second imaging test really depends on the experience of your institution and what's available. Though this is every endocrine surgeon's favorite slide, the only localization needed is a good surgeon. So ultrasound, as I mentioned, it's really easy to use. These are just some pictures of, you look for these sort of hypoechoic things that sit by your thyroid gland. Usually they have a little vessel off the side coming out, and it's separate from the thyroid gland. If you know where to look, they're pretty easy to see when they're there. Sestamibi scan has been around for a while, and as you can see, it gives you these very granular images. So if it's positive, it can give you sort of a quadrant of where to look, but that's basically it. And it's not good when there's generally one of these under other conditions present. So somebody has thyroid nodules, somebody's obese, somebody has thyroiditis, a lot of times your sestamibi is going to be negative. So two other newer imaging capabilities that I really like. One is fusing the sestamibi spec with CT scan. And this, not only do you get the functionality of your sestamibi, but you get the anatomic locations given by a CT scan. And secondly, I'm going to talk a little bit about 4D or 3D parathyroid CT, which is what I've been using lately and what we've now brought over to our hospital center, which basically takes the CT scan and as well as some functional imaging based on the rate of washout of contrast in your what could be a parathyroid adenoma versus the surrounding thyroid tissue or lymph nodes. So how it's done, first it was described with four phases. We have now cut this down to three phases to decrease radiation. And these are some of the imaging characteristics you look at to try to figure out what is an abnormal parathyroid adenoma. So why should we use this in our patients for our workup instead of some of the older imaging? So sensitivity is pretty good. Nothing is really good when you have multi-gland disease. And if you know somebody has four-gland hyperplasia or MEN preoperatively, honestly, imaging is not great because you need to do four-gland exploration in them anyways. Studies have shown shorter hospital stays and increased rates of being able to do a minimally invasive focused parathyroidectomy. Though it does not seem to decrease failure rates significantly. Compared to the sestamibi scan, if you're comparing it to, you do get a little bit extra radiation, but it takes much less time and is at least equivalent or a lot of times less cost to the patient. If you compare them, a few studies have shown that avoided unnecessary opposite side explorations, which therefore will decrease the rate of transient hypoparathyroidism. And when you meta-analysis that put together a bunch of studies and tried to compare ultrasound, sestamibi SPECT, not the MIBI CT and 4D CT, showed an increased sensitivity and a slightly increased positive predictive value. And again, none of this really matters much for multi-gland disease. When you look at cost, a really robust study that came out of our colleagues in Boston showed that ultrasound followed by a 4D CT or the MIBI SPECT CT were the least expensive and therefore most cost-effective strategies. And then briefly, I'm going to talk about surgery and then I'm going to stop because I am the surgeon. So we know parathyroidectomy improves for people that the parathyroid, hyperparathyroidism was causing these symptoms. It can improve neurocognitive function, fatigue and weakness, bone disease, kidney stones, peptic ulcers, cardiac and vascular dysfunction if it is significantly impaired pre-op. And there are differing opinions of this, and I'm not going to get into it. Does it improve death from cardiac disease or cardiac mortality? If it's untreated, though, there are studies that have shown it does, if you don't treat it, it does increase the risk of cardiovascular mortality and development of fatal and non-fatal disease. So, briefly, focused or minimal access parathyroidectomy has become the standard of care with intraoperative PTH monitoring. Old studies, which pretty much hold true, that if you have two imaging tests that are concordant and you don't have intraoperative PTH, you will probably be successful 95% of the time. And what minimal access means, it means different things to different people. I mean, it's a really small incision and we just look at one gland. Okay. And multiple surgical series have shown that it has equivalent long-term recurrence rates to bilateral neck exploration. So, all right, I won't play my little video. But as you can see, we can do really small incisions, as small as 1.5 centimeters, and really dissect minimal tissue and do it as outpatients. Patient gets to go home a couple hours after surgery. You want me to play my video? Okay. They're not as fancy as yours, though, so we'll see. We'll try. So I just, will this work? So this is just kind of a little bit about what we do for making this. So this is going through the tissue. We've now dissected down to the pre-cervical fascia. We are opening up the midline raphe, which separates your strap muscles. And now we have gotten down to the area just below the thyroid glands. You're seeing the parathyroid peek out in there. And I'll try to stop this if I can so we can look at it in a second. Oopsies. So if you can see, this is my parathyroid that I already kind of made pop out there. and we knew where it was beforehand, so it made it all really easy. And we're dissecting carefully around it, trying not to touch the gland if possible. And once we have it, we've tied off its blood supply and then try to take it out pretty easily. I do not do them awake, but our colleagues in New York City are very into doing these under local anesthesia. So if you have an anesthesiologist that has a lot of experience with cervical blocks and local anesthesia, these can be done that way. So we can try that if you want. Intraoperative diagnosis. This is something that I'm not going to get into today, but really I think confuses the literature about the incidence of single gland versus multi-gland disease. And again, that's a whole nother talk, is do you make your diagnosis based on your hormone or based on that your gland looks abnormal? So I personally feel like this is an endocrine disease. I want to make my diagnosis based on the hormones normalizing and not based on, oh, something looks kind of big, so it must be abnormal. Because you can have big glands that are not producing extra hormone. So that's another talk. But briefly, we do this. Miami criteria, you want your intraoperative pH levels to fall 50% in the operating room from the top. So I want my curve to look something like that or like that. A curve that looks like that at the beginning kind of sucks, and hopefully I went and found another gland and took it out, so then it fell. And again, a curve like that, people say, oh, it went down 50% from up here. Well, if you stop there, you're going to be missing disease, and you better be finding another gland, taking it out, and then letting your hormones levels drop. So some other nuances, how low does it need to be? I think everyone's pretty much in agreement that PTH should drop into the normal range. There's disagreement as to how low it needs to go, again, for another time. If you are operating an MEN1 or 4-gland hyperplasia, you probably want a much higher percent drop in your PTH to make sure you get all the disease that you need to. And with certain conditions, the PTH kinetics might be different, so you just need to be aware of that before you go in. And again, know where your missing parathyroids may be if you can't find them. Genetic testing, briefly. Young patients with primary hyperparathyroidism, anyone with multi-gland disease, you should probably at least think about it and discuss this with your endocrine team to see if you guys think somebody should get genetic testing. So in summary, primary hyperparathyroidism is increasingly common, unrecognized disease. Surgery is the only cure. The majority of patients can undergo successful outpatient parathyroidectomy when it's done by an experienced surgeon. Most can be accomplished with a minimal access approach, regardless of age and any comorbidities. And long-term recurrence rates are low when intraoperative PTH is used in guiding the extent of parathyroidectomy. And that's it.